The following thoughts on Hoppe Hour do not represent Cox Media Group or its sponsoring. Anything you hear may and will be used against you. Thank you. Voted as best local podcast in Tampa Bay by the Creative Loafing. You're listening to Hoppe Hour.
Are you feeling classy today? Sit down, pour a glass of wine, and listen to Hoppe Hour.
You're tuned in to Hoppe Hour, an hour where Hoppe rants about something. Sit back and listen in. Hoppe Hour is on now. Hoppe Hour is on now.
Yo, what up? This is Hoppe Hour. I am your host, Ryan Hoppe, and for the next hour, I want to change the way you think about things. For the next hour, I want my rants to expand your mind so that when you're listening right now, you go, I think about it this way. But once the show ends, I want my outrageous, outspoken opinion to change everything. So then you go, gee, Hoppe, you're a genius. Gee, Hoppe, you really are smart. So that is the whole point of Hoppe Hour. And I want to make you laugh. Maybe you're on the Howard Franklin and traffic is a bitch and you're listening to this live via the app or on demand. I want to make time go by. So I appreciate you listening. Tweet at me at Ryan Hoppe Radio. I have Twitter loaded up right now, so I will be sure to get your tweets in real time. Also, if you're listening via Spreaker or via the Hoppe Radio app, you can message me, and I will get the messages in real time, and I want to get that feature going. Now, you're probably wondering, Hoppe, where's Kyle Veit? Hoppe, you've been pumping up this new co-host, and he doesn't show up. What a tool. No, that's not it. During December, the schedule is going to be very bizarre because he's going to be coming on Tuesdays and Thursdays and when we do shows on Saturdays. So I'll be having my other co-host that we're going to begin. Once 2016 begins, watch out. But I have the third co-host, Super Rich. He'll call in too with the news. But for tonight's show, I kind of wanted to not have a co-host. I could have had Kyle call in and we recap Thanksgiving from last night. I could have had Super Rich call in and give me the news. I could have had a few girls that want to come on and give me dating advice. I could have had them on. But today is a show that I kind of want to have out there just because right now it's a weird era for me. Now, I'm 22 years old, so I'm very young, but my whole life, I always basically got along with my parents. I never was like a punk who would go out and party underage that much or smoke because, frankly, I wasn't really given the opportunity because I wasn't popular enough. So my point is, I've always kind of been a mama's boy, and I sort of was a daddy's boy, but me and my dad didn't always get along. But the thing with me and my dad was, even though he was so conservative and so just on the right side of wait till marriage, Family Guy is evil, we always got along. Even on the days that he was in a grumpy mood or even on the days that he was being a complete douche. Because there were days, me and my dad did not always get along. At times he would get me so mad that I would go for a walk and slam the door. Like, I'm not going to sit here and say that me and my dad were close, but we weren't like far apart. We just didn't really always get along. So that's what's been really rough about him being gone for a year now is the fact that we did watch Bears games together. He could kind of watch Aqua Teen Hunger Force. He liked watching Modern Family. Those were the three things we had in common. Besides that, we had nothing in common. And when he's alive, you kind of go, oh, he's a conservative douche. Oh, enough of you, Dad. You're so uptight and moral. But now looking back, you kind of realize that even though his parenting of being obsessive over me watching adult things didn't really work, he had good intentions. Forcing me to go to church, he had good intentions. And I kind of miss that part of my life. I kind of miss being held back and being forced to be a fake moral person, because ever since his passing, I did turn 21, so I basically just partied in Cleveland, and now I'm working my ass off in Tampa. But I kind of miss the hard-ass checking in. Where are you at? The hard-ass checking in. You better have the dishes good before I get home. So it's been a really weird era for me this last year since his passing on November 25th, 2014. Because when he first passed away, I could sit here and tell you lies and say I was so, so sad. Like, of course, when I find out my dad died, I fell to the couch. I wrote a post on Facebook because I wanted attention because I felt sad and shallow. But I kind of felt like, oh, now I get to party in Cleveland and not have to worry about what he thinks. But that's kind of what turned the down spiral until I got here to Tampa. So not having my dad in my life kind of made me a maniac during the winter. So let me explain what happened to people who don't listen to the radio and don't know how my dad lost his life. In April to May 2013, he began feeling very sick. Now, I thought he was just being an obnoxious person because, like I said, we weren't the closest. He began walking around the house wearing a hoodie. He would frown all the time. And it comes to be that he was having pre-leukemia, and I will never forget the date. It was like May 24th, 2013. He's at the hospital, and I'll never forget when my whole family told me, Ryan, sit down real quick. And I'm like, why? And they're like, Ryan, sit down real quick. It was one of those moments where when you hear that, you're like, oh, no. It wasn't like, sit down. You just won $1 million. And now you get to marry Megan Fox. It was one of those moments when they're like, sit down, Ryan. You're like, I will never forget when my dad told me, Ryan, I've been diagnosed with leukemia. It was one of those moments where you don't know what to say. Like, he's been a fighter his whole life. He's always been hardworking. He kept the house together. He would jog all the time. He always wanted to do a marathon. He went to church every day. I mean, he was the guy that was so moral and so conservative, it broke my heart immediately to find out that he had leukemia. It was like, I'm not saying somebody that's atheist and not moral would be more prone to get it, but it was like, this dude couldn't catch a break. So he goes to the hospital, he comes back, you know, for transfusions going in and out. And it was one of those things where when he would go to the hospital, you'd be like, yes, I get to have my friends over and he doesn't have to approve of them. Yes. And we would party. Oh, yeah. But then after a while, when he would come back and forth from the hospital, you would begin to miss him, which is what I'm going through right now. I keep having the feeling, oh, he's just on that break at the hospital. I'll see him soon. Oh, he'll be back soon. That's what's kind of eerie about him being gone for a year now, is you go, oh, yeah, Roy's going to come back soon. Dad, you're going to walk in. That's what's kind of weird about him passing away is if my mom were to pass away today, it would be so heartbreaking because we're so close. But with my dad, we were close, but we weren't. But after not seeing him for a while, that's when you would miss him. So that's kind of what I'm going through right now. Well, I was debating if I wanted to talk about this angle, but I've had people in radio tell me that you need to be open and you need to be real and you can't hold back. My dad was a bit of a hard ass in the way that it was his side of the highway or nothing. Like, he was always the most intelligent, right person in the room. He was never wrong, which was good and bad for him in life, but mainly it was good. He was very successful. We had a decent-sized house, but we had this huge dirt pit in the front yard because we couldn't afford to get the plumbing fixed. So we got the plumbing fixed, but we didn't get new sod and new dirt on the front lawn. So my dad was the guy where he would get angry at me whenever I would microwave cat food. And he's like, oh, you're trying to kill me. I'm just being real. We would have arguments. But then he was the guy that would just wear a mask, and he would be on the front lawn doing yard work, raking up leaves, digging up dirt. And that's like 101 of what you're not supposed to do when you have leukemia. You can't be around germs.
So he was doing well in August 2014. He got out of the hospital, but then it becomes fall in Chicago. You're raking leaves. You're doing the dirt pit. And come October 2014, he began to lose his hair again. He wasn't doing very well. And the thing that I can hold my head on is he saw me get hired by Rovers Morning Glory, and he saw me try out both times, and he was so proud of me because he never believed fully in me getting into radio, so I know he would be proud of me right now with everything I've done in Tampa. But it was one of those things where I tried out for Rover like in late October, got called back November 10th-ish, and then I waited a week or two. The week I find out I'm moving to Cleveland to work for the biggest show is the week he died. So this last few weeks has been really weird. And the way I found out that my dad passed away is, it's weird in the fact that this is something that happens in a horror movie. Like, I've been in kind of denial over the last year to the fact that I don't think about it. But when I tell my new friends that I meet in Cleveland or here in Tampa, or I tell an employer, how did your dad die? That's when you kind of realize that it's a bit traumatic. That's when you realize that I'm not putting the sympathy game on me, but it is a lot for me to take in on how I found out he passed away. So the week of Thanksgiving, so this was this week, a year ago, my mom went to Washington, D.C., to go visit my brother, or my uncle, that's her brother, who was not doing very well back then. He's not doing well now either. But back then, she went to go visit him. So it was me and my dad the week of Thanksgiving. And then Monday, this was supposed to be the last week before I moved to Cleveland, so I'm saying goodbye to all my friends. Then Monday, I went bowling with my friend, and I came home, and he was in a cheerful mood. He was making hot dogs. He was his same giddy, goofy self, like father, like son. So it was one of those things where you go, oh, dad's doing pretty good. But that Tuesday was bad. I went to Bar Louie with my friends, and we got cheeseburgers and watched the Bulls game. And I remember coming home, and the house reeked. He was absolutely sick. He couldn't find someone to drive him to the hospital to get a transfusion, and he was too weak, so the house reeked. And I will never forget walking in around 11 p.m. that Tuesday, and he dies on the Wednesday, the next day. And I'll never forget walking in that Tuesday and just going, oh, what's that smell? And you hope for the best. You really, really do. You hope it's just him being sick, but something in your heart tells you that it's not a good thing. So that Wednesday, I was practicing getting up early so I would be ready for the time frame of when you have to get up at 5 in the morning when I worked for Rover's Morning Glory. So I got up around 6 a.m. I was watching the show live. And I remember my dad came out into the living room. And I'm like, good morning, Dad. And he was in a very grumpy mood. Like, I wouldn't say always he was grumpy, but often he was grumpy. And he comes in, he's like, morning. So I'm making scrambled eggs. He goes in this back room. I don't see him for 9 hours. So from 8 a.m. till 5 p.m., I don't see him. And now this is where, I'm not saying I'm going to cry, but this is the last time I saw him. So what happened was, it's going on 5:15 p.m. to Wednesday before Thanksgiving. I'm watching Boardwalk Empire beginning to pack for Cleveland. And it's one of those things where you go, man, I haven't seen Dad for a while. Man, this is getting weird. But you just kind of hope for the best. You go, okay. Because you want to give him his space. He was such a territorial, goofy guy with a good heart that you respected his room and you wanted to give him his space, especially when he was sick. So it was one of those things where you just go, okay. Around 5:20 p.m., the day he died, I hear movement in the back room. So I go, okay, he's alive. And I hear the voicemail. And it goes, this is a voicemail from Monday, whatever the day was. And it's his doctor from the University of Chicago saying, Roy, we didn't see you this Monday. Are you okay? You need to get your blood transfusion. And there was something about him not moving for 2 days and something about him playing that voicemail and the guy giving him a call to check in, that just felt eerie. But you go, Dad's alive. There's nothing wrong with that situation. So I begin to hear the door open. My cats are going back there, whatever. I'm cooking dinner. So I go back there, and it was like I was looking at a different person. Like, he looked more like a 65-year-old man than he did a 51-year-old man. I mean, he was coughing left and right. He was leaning forward, and he couldn't breathe. He's like, Ryan, I can't breathe. Ryan, I can't breathe. And I'm like, Dad, what can I do for you? What can I do for you? And he goes, just go to Mickey D's and give me an iced tea. Give me a sweet tea, which was his favorite. I'm like, okay. So I go to Mickey D's. I give my aunt a call. I'm like, I don't know. Dad's acting weird. So she calls him, and he's like, I'm okay. I'm okay. I'll be at Thanksgiving the next day. So I come back at like 5:52 p.m. after I left at like 5:35 to get his Mickey D's. He's coughing left and right. He's not doing good whatsoever. But he's being the hard-ass, I'm the smartest dude in the room, where I don't need help. I was in the Navy. I don't need help. I'm a man, which I respect about him. He always wanted to be independent. So I go, Dad, I have to go to Myers, which is a local, sort of like a Walmart in Illinois. I have to go to Myers to get Gatorade and clothes for when I'm moving on Monday. The way he had to reach into his wallet to give me the credit card, it was like I was watching a 92-year-old man trying to pick up a glass of water. It was eerie. And I remember I'm thinking, oh, man. So he gives me his credit card. And the last thing that we ever said to each other, he said to me, don't spend too much on the credit card. And then I said, I love you, Dad. And I said, I love you, too. So it's one of those things where that's something that I will always take in, is not to spend too much on the credit card. And when a show that I was working for at the time was kind of making fun of me and I was getting mad, he said to me, that's show business for you. So the two things that I learned during my dad's last day on earth was, that's show business for you when people in radio are picking on you to be thick-skinned, and not to spend too much on the credit card. So what happens is I end up going to the gym around 6:30 p.m. I go to Myers, blah, blah, blah. I have the best workout of my life. Come back at 9:30. I'm all jacked up on Mountain Dew. I'm all jacked up on my workout supplement. So I'm in a great mood. I just swam 20 laps or whatever. Blaring Lil Wayne in the car. So I come home and I go, Dad, I have the credit card. I go, Dad, I have the credit card. No answer. I'm like, Dad, I have the credit card. And I go back there. And he's leaned on the side of the bed as if you're ready to get up in the morning, but he's leaned back. So I'm going, oh, Dad, wake up. Dad, wake up. And the only way I would hear him breathe was when I would kind of try to give him CPR. So I'm thinking, okay, he's just not doing well. So I give 911 a call, and I'm saying how I have a bad vibe about it, this and that. And she's like, well, is he breathing on his own? And I go, yeah, when I push on his heart and on his lungs. She goes, no, is he breathing on his own? And right then and there, I got a weird vibe. So the ambulance comes while I'm on the phone for 6 minutes. And I give my mom a call, and we're just talking. And immediately, I hear, like, all the people from the ambulance in my dad's back room. And it was one of those things where you have a bad vibe, but you keep lying to yourself. You're like, oh, no, no, they're just surprised that he's not doing well. So what happens is the cop comes into the living room and he goes, he taps me on the shoulder and he goes, Ryan, he's gone. And I go, what do you mean? He goes, Ryan, your dad passed. And I immediately had the feeling like I drank a whole bottle of vodka. Like, I can't explain how you go from being feeling sober and having hope to immediately feeling like you drank a whole bottle of $5 vodka from Walgreens. I mean, you immediately, you feel dizzy, this and that. So my family came, and it's one of those things where I was debating if I wanted to tell you guys this, because I've said this on Kelta Show. I told this on Rover's Morning Glory. I talked about it on another show in Canada, but it was one of those things where I said, do I want to talk about it? But it's one of those things where you have to be real and open with your show. You can't always be the outspoken DJ, the outspoken talk show host. Some people like to use the despicable word of shock jock. You can't always be the in-your-face guy ranting, so I wanted to be real and honest. So I'm going to begin doing some segments where my dad never was really a part of my radio career just because he didn't really believe in it at times. So I'm going to share some of my favorite memories with him and some of the funny times. So I'm going to begin doing that segment every once in a while. But it's one of those things where if you have a dad or a mom that you're mad at right now, or if you have an uncle, a teacher, a mentor, a sibling, anybody in your life, your girlfriend, your significant other, whatever, that you're mad at or you're thinking, oh, he's a hard ass, just do me a favor and go up to them, give them a call if they're on the other side of the country, and just say to them that you love them, because at least I can say that I said that as being the last words ever to my dad. But, like, I really want to say it to him right now. Like, with everything I am trying to accomplish in radio at this young age, and I'm so honored with the opportunity that Mike Olivero, Rob Gargiulo, Mike Kelta, John Brennan have given me, I want my dad to see this. So if there's something you're accomplishing that you want them to know about, but maybe you're in a bit of a weird mood, just give them a call. Maybe you guys don't get along at all. Maybe he's an absolute douche. Maybe you despise your dad. Just give him a call, because once he's gone, that's when you're going to wish that you gave them a call. And I can't say that I could have done more because he was such a hard ass, but it's one of those things where it's just each and every day when I go to bed, you're just kind of like, oh yeah, dad's gone. So I appreciate everyone that's been listening to the last 22 minutes of this. It's just, I was debating how I wanted to approach it because I didn't want to be dramatic and sad, but I'm like, at some point, you can't deny the fact that your dad's gone, because it's not healthy to be in denial. And it's like, I don't want to depress my mom when I talk about it, or my aunt, because they're feeling the same way. So I wanted to have a way to vent and a way to be real. So I appreciate all the kind words I've been getting on Hoppe TV just now on Periscope or via Twitter or via Facebook. Basically, the support I get from New York, Cleveland, Louisville, and obviously here in the Bay Area and in Chicago, it means the world to me, because I push each and every day to make it in radio. I push each and every day to make it in life, because my dad did the same thing. And coming up next on Hoppe Hour, I'm going to be ranting about the news, because I thought, should I make this just a segment where I talk about my dad? But I go, my dad wouldn't want it to be all about him. He would want me to live life and rant about the news. Tweeted me at Ryan Hoppe Radio. And of course, you can chat me via Hoppe TV on Periscope and via email. We will be right back on Hoppe Hour after this. Hang on.
Hoppe Hour. Hoppe Hour.
Hey, it's Ryan Hoppe from the award-winning Hoppe Hour, and I am here today to speak about the best in the Bay when it comes to landscaping, irrigation, sod, waterfalls, and ponds. My guy Jeff, over at Amazing Gardens Land and Waterscapes, has the best team when it comes to getting it done in a fast and in a very accurate pace. Maybe you're sick of your lawn and you want to have it be redone. Amazing Gardens is the business for you. Or maybe you're moving into the new home and you're not happy with the lawn, or you need to get a new lawn. Call Amazing Gardens. Trust me when I say the crew is hardworking and they get it done in a very accurate and timely fashion. To get into contact with Amazing gardens, land, and waterscapes, it's not hard. It's not rocket science. It's not trigonometry. All you have to do is call them at 727-871-9224. That's 727-871-9224. And when you call them, make sure that you say that Ryan Hoppe sent you, and they will give you a badass deal. And like they say, let us dreamscape your landscape at down-to-earth prices. Trust me when I say they're the best in the Bay.
What's up? This is Ryan Hoppe from Hoppe Hour, and I have a very special shout-out to one of the sponsors of this award-winning podcast. Nicholas Seymour from Duluth, Minnesota, is the owner of Soli's Graphics, which is a badass company that will make you decals. You can buy Hoppe Hour decals. It's not too hard. For just $4, you can support this award-winning podcast while supporting small business here in America. Or maybe you have a band, a company, a freelancing project, and you want to have your logo made into a nice, badass decal. Nick is down for making deals, and he is very good at negotiating. If you want to get into contact with Nick, it's not hard. Trust me. He will answer your call real quick, and he is one of the nicest guys I know. His number is 330-419-0691. That is 330-419-0691. Or you can send him an email, soliesdesign@gmail.com. That is soliesdesign@gmail.com. And to check out Hoppe Hour decals for just $4, go to tinyurl.com/hoppehourdecal. That is tinyurl.com/hoppehourdecal. And when you talk to my guy, Nick, just say that Ryan Hoppe sent you, and he will give you a badass deal. Trust my word, pimps. Nick Seymour of Soli's Graphics is the best around.
Live from the Sunshine State, this is Hoppe Hour.
It's time to turn Hoppe on. It's time to turn Hoppe on. It's time to turn Hoppe on.
All right, welcome back to Hoppe Hour. I am your host, Ryan Hoppe. Now, this next topic I'm going to talk about isn't exactly exciting, but I need to rant. And this topic is something that needs to get discussed because we are treating pedophiles way too nicely, and I am sick and tired. I'm not going to sit here and pretend that I'm a lawyer or I'm a judge and I'd be really good at figuring out how to give them how much time in jail or if they deserve the death penalty or not, if that makes sense. But something needs to change. Because this headline, this despicable cretin, this imbecile who is not being put to death immediately is an absolute joke. What if this dude did this to your kid? Ridiculous. And I'm not saying going to jail for 500 years is a piece of cake. I'm not saying going to jail for 500 years literally is like laying on the top floor of a Hilton motel with models around you. Obviously, going to prison sucks. But you're alive every day and you're breathing. Here's what this guy did. And the fact that he got 580 years in jail. The fact that he's not dead right now. The fact, and I've been kind of holding back this next opinion because I didn't want to be too edgy, but screw it. The fact that we're not throwing rocks at him, an eye for an eye, the fact that we're not having Ronda Rousey kick his ass or Mike Tyson kick his ass is a joke. Travesty. Yeah, because they want to have sex with kids. Whatever. I'm not saying going to jail for 500 years is easy. But I think I'd rather do that. I honestly would rather do that. And you know when they're going to go to jail, they're going to be given the treatment in a way that they're not going to get along with general population, so then they'll be given their own cell. Because I'm sick and tired of hearing, oh, they'll get the treatment in jail from Jerome. No, they don't. Because these sick pedophiles are the lowest on the totem pole in prison. So they don't get along with people because they're weird. They want to have sex with kids. So what happens is they end up getting a cell by themselves because they don't get along with their roommate. They don't get along in the courtyard, or they don't get along at lunch. So enough of the being alive, they get their ass kicked. No, no, they don't. You see James Holmes, he gets the treatment. He gets his own cell. But it says here, and this is despicable. This is from the Daily Mail. Prosecutors seek 580 years. Yeah, that's a lot. Yet it's life in prison. But why is he not being killed? Okay. What he did is so unordinary for a pedophile. I'm not saying any act is ever ranked, because touching a kid or even thinking about it to me is equal. Because when you're attracted to kids, you're sick in the head, you're a mental patient, and there's something wrong with you, and there's no way to fix it. Because I'm sick and tired of hearing, oh, well, but you put them in those classes in the church basement, and that's going to really help. How about us heterosexuals or homosexuals or people that want to change into a different sex, put them in a church basement and try to force them to be attracted to something else? So if you're a homosexual, take them to a camp and make them straight. Take me to a camp and make me homosexual. There's no way to ever change what you're attracted to. So what I'm getting at is, I'm sick and tired of hearing, but they put them in treatment. There's no treatment to what you're attracted to. Shut up. God, it gets me so mad. Because here's what this dude did. He's a father of three, so he's related to them, who kidnapped and sexually abused two Amish girls and chained them to the bed, as well as four other kids. The fact that he's not being put to death right now, the fact that we're not chaining him to a bed and we're not having Mike Tyson punch him over and over, the fact that he's even going to jail is an absolute joke. It's an idiocracy. Because he's 40 years old. So this is going to be the rest of his life. It's not like he's 70 years old where he could die tomorrow. He seems like he's in decent shape. Michael Howells and his former girlfriend, Nicole Vasey, lured two girls, which is, ugh. They enticed the girls. They brought them in. The thing that gets me so mad, especially about how we treat the whole idea of pedophilia and how we criminalize it, is the fact that we're so lenient on them because we don't want to think about what they did. It's so sick. It's so mind-warping. It makes you want to vomit. So what I'm getting at is, if we truly think about the dude that chains kids to bed because he's attracted to them, grab a gun. Once he's found guilty, take him to the shed, put him in a chair, whatever. He kidnapped girls from a family lemonade stand in August 2014. So it wasn't like this was 10 years ago. I was at a radio conference in August. People were on vacation. Imagine what you're doing while these girls are getting kidnapped in recent times. Because I feel like sometimes when these cases come out and they're from like 2004, we're kind of numb to it because we're like, oh, yeah, Michael Jackson touching kids. Oh, yeah, Dahmer. Like, they're all jokes now. Like, we all make Jerry Sandusky jokes or Michael Jackson jokes. Jesus juice. I'll get it. But back then, we didn't like Michael Jackson. What I'm getting at is, this is recent times, so we should be infuriated by it. Authorities say the girls were held captive for 24 hours. Imagine how long that time is. Before couples, they were held for 24 hours before the sick in the head couple panicked from the media attention of them being missing, and they dumped them in an isolated area. Michael Howells also pleaded guilty to kidnapping and sexually exploiting four other children, ranging from the age of 3 to 11, whatever. Give him 580 years in jail where he's eating every day and he's breathing and he's thinking, just kill him, whatever. Age 3 to 11. If I were the dad of these girls, That should be one of the punishments. Let that dad be in a room with this scumbag for at least 30 seconds and just let him pound him. And I know that sounds aggressive. I know that sounds mean and like a shock jock, but I'm being serious here. This is life, and these girls' lives are screwed forever because of Michael Howells. Let that dad kick his ass. It's one of those things where I hold it back because it's not a topic people want to hear about, but this is life. Their lives might be affected forever because of Michael Howells. Something we need to discuss. We're not charging them hard enough. Guess why he abducted the girls? It wasn't that he was lonely. It wasn't that he needed friends. No. They weren't his slaves. All those things would be bad. But what he kidnapped them for, what he did and his plan was, is so sickening, is so infuriating, he should be shot immediately. I'm going to go out and say it. He kidnapped them to attempt to make a porno with them. Yep. That's the guy we're giving 580 years in jail. That's the dude we're paying for his taxpayers. The taxpayers are paying for him to be in jail. That's the dude that gets to breathe every day. That's the dude that gets to think about what he did every day and probably gets happy about it. That's the dude. Kidnapped kids between the age of 5 and 11 to make a porno with them. Ridiculous. And his point was to have them be his slave. Whatever. Moving on. What's going on with Kim Kardashian's fat ass? And the only reason I hear about this is because I go on the Daily Mail, which is a news site like CNN, MSNBC, Fox News. The Huffington Post is utter trash. You hear about none of this news like this. Oh, Kim Kardashian's looking pretty fat. Or you hear about Ben Carson said this. Or you hear about Donald Trump said this. Even though everybody says something in politics that's hypocritical. So what I'm getting at is it's a sad day in America that you hear about this from a foreign news site about something that happened here in America. This should be discussed everywhere. How we are giving these pedophiles treatment. By not putting these despicable pieces of, and you know what? I often don't swear on my podcast. If I have a comedian on, I might drop a swear or two. And I use the words dirtbag, cretin, imbecile. But for this, I'm going to say it. This fucking piece of shit should die. Ridiculous. You're going to give a dude that wanted to make a porn with kids actual time to breathe during the day. Obviously, he's not on the Caribbean beach relaxing with girls or living the life. He's not at a nice mansion. You know, like, I'm not saying going to prison is fun, like I've said before, but so infuriating. And I feel like I'm the only person saying this, and I'm sort of in the media. I'm around people in the media, but I'm not like a media member. Like, I would love that this rant got some attention somewhere because no one says it. You don't hear my take on this from CNN, Fox News, MSNBC. You sometimes hear it from talk radio shows, but you never hear enough people say that they should just be killed immediately. I hear guys like Opie or Jim Norton or Anthony Cumia, my heroes, say that, or Howard says that, but not enough people say it. But it's one of those things where the common person, the common everyday person goes, oh, they'll get their treatment in jail. No, they won't. Looking at him and his wife. What's sad about it, and I'll show it on Hoppe TV, this is the couple that we're giving time to breathe in jail. That's them. Look at that. If you're watching on Hoppe TV, they have the face of like a camp counselor that you can trust. So that obviously means that they know how to entice kids. That obviously means they're very good at getting the kids' trust because Michael Howells had over 200,000 images and 900 videos of child porn. Whatever, 500 years in jail, whatever. He did film the whole thing. Got that wrong before, so He pleaded guilty to conspiracy to produce child porn, producing child porn, and possession of child porn. They also found hard drives of images on his computer. Ugh. And you look at them, his mugshot is more of, oh no, I got caught. Like sometimes with a mugshot, you can tell if the person's sad or not, or you can tell if the person feels bad or not just by the way they look in the eyes. Like when you look at James Holmes's mugshot, it's, I got my job done. Or when you look at a mugshot of some guy who's a gangbanger, it's more, oh man, I got caught. That's what I see with this one. Like sometimes when a mother accidentally drowns her kid and you see the red eyes in a mugshot, you can kind of tell that she feels bad. With this dude, I kind of get the vibe that he's mad he got caught. It's not, oh no, the poor kids, I'm sorry. Trust me. Because when you have hard drives of porn and you're doing things like this, you should be dead. Yeah, it says here, evil has no limit. That's a very or Superman trying to take down the bad guys. Like that's what you think of when you think of the word evil, or you think of terrorists, or you think of anything like Bowser from Super Mario. Like to me, when you think of evil, you think of more of a fictional version of evil. But pedophiles are evil. Pedophiles want to touch kids. They're attracted to kids. Murderers are evil. Gangbangers that take a 9-year-old in an alley and kill the kid and assassinate him, that's evil. I feel like we don't use that word enough to describe these pieces of dirt. And I'm not trying to depress you, but the media is all about talking about, oh, Charlie Sheen had sex with trannies and has HIV, or red coffee cups. But we need to talk about more things like this, because if we don't, these pedophiles will keep acting up and keep going under the radar. Because imagine if we put in some law or some criteria where once the pedophiles are found guilty, they are given a death sentence. I'm not saying by putting in that law and implementing it that everything would be fixed and pedophilia would go away. But I feel like some of these guys would be like, eh, I don't really believe in an afterlife. Eh, God's not real. I don't really want to be dead forever and take the dirt nap yet. So I'm not going to act on it. But when these guys act up, they might have the mindset of, I'm going to get caught, but I'm a loser who lives in my mom's basement. So would I rather have her feed me spaghetti every night or just live in jail? I'm just saying. All righty.
Next on Hoppe Hour.
All right, next on Hoppe Hour. A Texas mother gave marijuana and beer to 8 girls during the daughter's sleepover. And everyone's so outraged. Deservedly so. Everyone's so surprised. Not deservedly so. Because I'm going to explain to you why this is a norm. Everyone's like, oh, Texas is crazy. Trust me when I say everybody knows somebody that has a parent that has done this for their kids. I'm just saying. Tweet at me, @ Ryan Hoppe Radio. We will be right back on Hoppe Hour after this. Hang on.
Hoppe Hour. Hoppe Hour.
And since I did talk about the passing of my dad, and I did talk about pedophiles, I kind of want to play a song that could cheer you up. I kind of want to play a song that could bring in a vibe of happiness. So here's my guy, Andy Williams. It's the most wonderful time of the year, officially.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. With the kids jingle-belling and everyone telling you be of good cheer. It's the most wonderful time of the year. It's the happiest season of all. with those holiday greetings and gay happy meetings when friends come to call. It's the happiest season of all. There'll be parties for hosting, marshmallows for toasting, and caroling out in the snow. There'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. Yes, the most wonderful time. Oh, the most wonderful time of the year.
Hoppe ran so hard he starts to sweat. It's basically his cardio. Hoppe Hour is on.
All righty, welcome back to Hoppe Hour. I am your host, Ryan Hoppe. Tweet at me so that I get your tweets in real time. At Ryan Hoppe Radio. Follow my co-host. He's not here right now. Throughout December, it's going to be a weird schedule to the fact that he works a second job. He has a wife and kids, even though he's 25 years old. He's very successful. So my point is, he kind of needs to see his daughter and not just be focused on a freelancing podcast. So beginning in January, we will be doing more shows together. But that's why it is called Hoppe Hour 2.0, because he will be here on Tuesdays and Thursdays. I will have my other co-host, Super Rich, call in. But I will be here to rant about things and give my take. So follow Kyle on Twitter. At Hoppe Radio Kyle and tweet at my co-host Ryan Superich at RyanStuprich. All right. To me, underage drinking and teenage smoking and all that is something that everybody does, or everybody at least knows somebody that does it. Parents often, when they have kids, they want to lie to their kids and say, oh, I never done that as a kid. But then when you grow older and you're around a bonfire at age 23 drinking, that's when the kids admit to their parents, oh, yeah, I used to smoke weed when I would drive around, you know. Or they would say to, or their parents would say to the kids, I did smoke weed as a kid. Like partying and drinking as a teen, I'm not saying is a necessity of life, but everybody does it. I mean, if you don't, then you're a clean-cut, great person. And one of the things that's really awkward about that is a lot of people try to pretend that the whole thing of parents giving marijuana and beer at parties is such a foreign idea. No one does it. It never happens. Trust me. It happens so often, anybody who's moral and conservative and clean cut would be surprised by how often it is. Your best friend probably did it if he's a parent or she's a parent. Or your best friend at least knows somebody. We all know somebody that's done it. Because drinking weed and beer, especially in 2015, is such a norm and so normal that it happens all the time. Because I see this headline from the Daily Mail. Says here, Texas mother gave marijuana and beer to 8 girls during daughter sleepover. Yes, she should be charged, because when you put yourself in that situation, it's a very dumb idea. and you have the risk of getting caught. But I love how this is like news, because, I mean, this happens so often. Mandy Wells, age 32, allegedly packed marijuana into a Hello Kitty bowl. I don't know why that cracks me up. I guess it's just because she's smoking with 14-year-olds that she was trying to kind of fit in. Like, if you're smoking with a bunch of 18-year-olds with dreadlocks, you would have a Bob Marley bowl. Or if you're smoking with a bunch of athletes, you might have a bowl of, like, their favorite player or their favorite NFL team. But she's smoking with 14-year-olds, so she has a Hello Kitty pipe. I don't know why that makes me laugh. They say that the mom also gave the girls two beers each. Oh, man. I don't feel bad that she got charged, because you're putting yourself in that situation. But I will say this. If anybody out there thinks that what Mandy Wells in Texas, his mother, did is so outrageous, then you know nothing about the culture of underage drinking. Then you know diddly squat about life and social situations. Trust me. There was this kid on the other block. We ended up being friends, but now we've lost touch. And he would have the wildest parties. Age 16, 17, kids smoking weed, kids drinking. And I never was invited in. I was on the do not let in list. He had a list, like a nightclub in downtown Tampa or Liquid in Cleveland or some club in Chicago. He literally had a list on a notepad of who to let in and who not to let in. And basically the people that weren't allowed in was me and a few girls that basically slept with everyone in high school that no one respected. So if you think that this mom giving the kids weed and alcohol is bad, it is very bad. It's a dumb idea. You're putting yourself in an awful situation. But if you think that this mom is out of the norm and it never happens, then you're so wrong. My friend's mom would literally supply the booze. The basement would have girls twerking and grinding, people smoking weed, and there'd be ecstasy pills. I never was invited to the parties, and I'm glad I didn't, because the cops would often come because they were so loud. But if you think a mom giving her kids a Hello Kitty pipe and drinking beer is so outrageous, it is outrageous, but it's not the wackiest thing of all time. That's what I'm getting at. It says here, she allows her 14-year-old daughter to self-medicate herself and her depression with marijuana. I don't know what to think of that, because I feel like underage kids shouldn't be smoking weed ever. Like, they shouldn't. But like I said, a mother from Illinois who knowingly knew that kids were taking ecstasy in the basement at age 16, I just kind of think is worse than a mom who probably doesn't know how to help her daughter with depression. Like, it's a dumb idea to give your kid weed. Trust me. I'm not defending Mandy Wells of Texas at all. I'm just saying this article is making her out to be the worst mom ever. Oh, no. She's a bad mom. She's a dumb mom. She might be naive. But my friend's mom that knew that kids were taking ecstasy, to me, that's a little bit iffier. Just saying. They found cans of beer in one of the three children's bedrooms. Now, underage drinking is bad, especially when you're 14 years old, because what is that? It's eighth grade. It's kind of when everybody begins. But they're not children. They're teens. They're young adults. They're preteens. To me, children is anything up to like fifth grade. So this article is trying to be dramatic by saying in the children's room. No, 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 no. Stop it. The teens room. Just saying. Wells told police that the girls did not require special attention after they got high and that she kept them under control. I'm sure she did. Most parents that have drinking parties for their kids, it is under control. Because a lot of times the kids sleep over, you give them the keys. Like at the prom party I went to after prom, a lot of times it is under control. So I don't feel bad for the mom because she's a dummy, especially when they're in eighth grade. But for the article to make it seem like she's the worst mom ever, like, you might need to do some looking into what goes on in the suburbs of Chicago or the suburbs of any city ever. Cleveland goes hard. I was above 21 when I lived in Cleveland, but that city drinks a lot. And I would hear crazy things about teen parties that would get into trouble in Avon, Ohio, Lakewood, or Rocky River. I'm just saying. So, yeah, and you see a picture. She seems like a good mom. Like, she's probably a good person. She's not a great mom. She's not going to get a Mother of the Year cup. But I kind of want the Daily Mail to look into the parents from Chicago that were giving their kids, or they knew about their kids doing ecstasy in the basement. I don't want those parents to get caught per se, but I do. It's just, I find it funny that out of all the cases, this is the one we kind of talk about. Like, it's bad, it's awful, it's dumb, it's moronic. But when you look at her house, it's a trailer park. So I'm really not surprised that she was giving her kids weed when you live there. They do say the place was a garbage dump. It was filthy. Well, I would assume a mother that's letting her 14-year-old kid smoke weed out of a little kiddie pipe, I didn't assume she would be living in a mansion with like 9 houses, a bathtub the size of the backyard. Like, I didn't think it was going to be a mansion when a mother is offering weed to her kids. I'm just saying. All righty. Here is the deal.
Next on Hoppe Hour.
Before we get up on out of here on Hoppe Hour, we have so much to get into. There is this Chicago teen. Like I said, Chicago parties very hard. There's a Chicago teen who killed his family kitten with his bare hands after his sister refused to give his bong back. And we will get into that and more. What a happy show. After this on Hoppe Hour, tweet at me, at Ryan Hoppe Radio. We will be right back. Hang on.
gonna switch this thing back. I'ma put it on your.
We will be right back on Hoppe Hour. But like I said, I want to kind of pump up the mood, get you guys going. So here's my guy, George Michael, Wham, with Last Christmas. This is my jam, yo.
Hey, it's Justin from the Justin Scott and Spiegel Morning Show on 98 Rock in Baltimore, and you're listening to Hoppe Radio.
Oh, yeah. Doesn't this just put you in that certain mood? laying back on the beach, chilling with your girl, sipping on a nice Bud Light, you know? It puts you in a certain mood where maybe you're cruising down the highway and you're in, like, let's say you're on a road trip to San Diego and you're, like, in a nice Corvette, maybe like Paul Walker's Corvette, and you're just driving along the mountains and you're trying not to go off the cliff and you're just cruising to this song. I don't know. That's just what it reminds me of. Maybe because it's called Late Night Drive, that it would make sense that you would think about a late night drive, but it's one of those songs that I meditate to. Relaxes me. So yeah, I'm very big into meditation now. I'm very big into relaxing. My mom and my whole family's into praying. I wouldn't say I'm atheist, but meditating's for me. So there you go. Tweet at me at Ryan Hoppe Radio. Email me, ryan@hoppyradio.com. Also go to hoppyradio.com and download my app into Google Play and iPhone Shop to search up Hoppe Radio. It's not rocket science. There you can chat me live. You can hear all 34 of my interviews and my rants. All right. I saw this headline, and this is just sad. This is what happens when you don't know what you're doing in your life and you're nothing but a loser pothead who lived for marijuana in high school. Time passed by. You didn't know what you're doing. And your parents are like, oh, Axel will get it together. He's going to quit smoking weed out of his room and thinking we don't know about it. Oh, Axel will get it together. And he's going to finally get out of his fifth year at a community college. Oh, Axel will get it together. Everyone else did. This kid is the example of somebody where he was probably the cool kid in high school. Everyone liked him. But this is why to anybody who's in high school, it doesn't matter if you're cool. Because a lot of times the kids that are cool in high school, hey, that rhymed, end up being losers in life, like this one. A Chicago teen killed the family kitten with his bare hands after his sibling refused to give his bong back. What a loser. You're so addicted to weed mentally because you have nothing going on in your life, because you have no personality, no credibility, and nobody likes you besides the friends that were using you for your weed. So, oh no, the sibling maybe took it away as a joke or is trying to help you. So you take it out on a kitten, you little bitch. Ridiculous. It's amazing what drugs can do. And people go, oh, but weed's not addicting. It's not addicting like coke. Not addicting like heroin, but you can get mentally addicted to it, where when you become potheads like Axel Salami of this kid from Chicago, you become so addicted to it that you don't know what you're supposed to do when you're not high, because you're a loser and you have no ideas because you've spent your whole teenage years getting baked. I've seen it countless times, and I'm not going to sit here and act all self-righteous because I don't smoke and because I know what I want to do in my life, but there's so many kids that smoked in high school and they don't know what they're doing. Like, it's cool to smoke. I'm sure it's great. I mean, I have no problem with weed. I'm just saying, I love people that go, there's nothing wrong with it. You get so addicted to it that you don't know what you're supposed to do when you're sober. Axel Salami, 18 years old, allegedly purposely crushed the cat to death in his hands. Ugh. Can you imagine? Like, when I pick up my cat, I never squish her, but she's a very hyper cat that likes to move around a lot. So I don't really throw her in the air, but I toss her like maybe a half a centimeter up because she's just a very hyper cat that likes to play. And even then, I feel like I'm playing too hard on her, because like she's so aggressive. She literally is like a dog that she likes it when you bring like a toy around and she's freaking out. But can you imagine playing with the cat and being so aggressive and so mean and so harsh to it that you crush it with your hands? When I pick up my cat, I have it in the air and I pick it up and I put her on like my shoulder. I feel like that's torturing because I'm 6'9" and I'm goofy and I'm uncoordinated. So when I walk around, I feel like I'm going to drop her. Can you imagine picking up your cat and killing it, you punk ass bitch? He, of course, admitted what he'd done to the police because he had no comeback, no originality, and he was obviously guilty. He's like, yeah, man, I killed the cat. The cat's out of the bag now. Ugh. Prosecutors say his sibling refused to return his water pipe, so he killed the cat and threatened to kill another one. Can you imagine seeing that in real time? Because I'll often look at my cat and I go, man, they're so innocent. Man, all they do is eat, poop, and sleep and meow. Can you imagine taking out your aggression on an innocent little being, you little punk-ass loser? You scumbag, you cretin. The flint that I just picked up from the ground has more intelligence and is more likable and is going more far in life than you ever were going to, buddy boy. It says here an 18-year-old in Illinois is being accused of killing his cat with his bare hands. The cat, which was only 7 weeks old, so it's so small and compact, was crushed to death inside the home in Crystal Lake, Illinois, which my uncle lives around there, so that's kind of weird. Small world, after all. Salami, whose mother runs an animal shelter out of their house, has been charged with felony, aggravated animal cruelty, and criminal damage to an animal. And you look at his face. And like I said before, I'm decent at reading mugshots just because I do so much news on Hoppe Hour. He kind of has the face where he feels bad, but he kind of has the face of shame. Like, it's not the face of, oh no, I got caught. I can tell he feels bad. It's just, dude, like, that's when weed takes you over, when you're fiending for your bong so much that you take away a cat's life. And I also feel bad for his mom. She's running animal shelter out of their house. Imagine the scrutiny, and the anger and the watchingness that people will be giving that place, if you know what I mean. Like before, they're like, oh, it's just some animal shelter out of the suburbs. Now they might have to close it down because of their punk-ass son. I'm sure nothing has ever happened before this, but now they might have to shut down. Think about that. This punk-ass little pothead bitch loser is so self-centered and may have ruined the mom's hobby or her job. And you look at his Facebook picture. Oh, he's so edgy, dude. Watch out. He's wearing a selfie. I'll show you guys on Hoppe TV. Here is his selfie. He's wearing a flat top hat. He's wearing a Mickey D shirt with Ronald McDonald holding a machine gun. He's so edgy and wild, man. Watch out. This is the guy you want to bring home to your parents on Thanksgiving. Look at him. Ooh. I have no problem with selfies because I take a lot of them because I have a very big ego. I have a very odd ego to the fact that I'm all about making it in radio. So I take selfies when I'm out with Kyle. But it's one of those things where when you take a mirror picture and you're so edgy wearing your wild flat top hat and Ronald McDonald with a machine gun, that means you're a loser. And Mark Zuckerberg probably should have shut down your Facebook account. It shouldn't be up if that's your picture and you have this mean mug and face like, ooh, watch out. I'm a rich suburban punk who smokes too much weed from the suburbs. I'm going to kick your ass. Ugh. I've seen plenty of this, too, because Chicago is so upscale and rich that all the suburban kids get influenced by the awful Chicago rap like Chief Keef, Lil Durk, all that, that they want to be like the man. They want to be mean mugging, and they want to be so cool. Hey, they kill people in Chicago. I'm just going to kill a cat, man. Ugh. I've seen this countless times. All right. Says here, attorney Kay Leonard said, Salami squeezed the cat to death after the sibling refused to return the water pipe. I love how they call it a water pipe. I've never heard anybody, unless you go to a smoke shop, say, hey, bro, pass the water pipe. I've never heard that. It's usually a bong. Hey, dude, where'd you get that water pipe? You've heard like bubbler and that, but I've never heard anybody call it a water pipe. I mean, it barely looks like a pipe. It's like a little round thing. It's a bong. I love how the news has to be so literal. The water pipe. Because that's what you smoke out of. That's what all the potheads say. Hey, Jeff, Dude, that new marijuana you have works real well with the water pipe. Salami, the punk-ass teen, argued with his father, who would not allow him to sell his sibling's TV because he's a punk-ass loser who probably lives at home. They keep saying, come on, Axel, you got to get a job. Come on, Axel, you got to do something with your life. And he wants to sell that TV just for that quick fix of either ecstasy or weed or any other hard drugs he does because he's a lazy loser who's probably rich in the suburbs and has lived off his parents forever and has no passion and no work initiative and nothing going on in his life. Loser with a capital L on your head. When you kill your family's cat right in front of them because they won't give you the bong back. And the argument began because you wanted to sell your sister's TV. It's not your possession. It's not the TV that's laying out in the garage that no one uses. It's your sister's possession, you dirtbag. He also said, I thought when I would kill it that it would be more hard. The cat's 7 weeks old. It's probably a small kitten. We are human beings. We have big hands. We are strong. Even if you're fat or you're skinny or you're lanky, we are so much stronger than animals. Like when I walk around the house and I'll look at Lily walking around, it's weird because like you look down and you're like, oh my God, she's like a half a foot and I'm 6 foot eight. We're so much bigger than the animals. So the excuse of, I didn't know that was going to happen when I put my two hands together in a hard, angry manner, doesn't really work. Because what's the self-defense the cat's going to do? Meow! And then scratch you? They can't do anything. They're not pit bulls. He called his mother, told her that he had killed the kitten because he's so outrageous and wild, man. And then said, I'm going to kill another one if she don't give me my bong back. What are you going to think about when you're high after you killed a cat? Yeah, that cat's gone forever. Yeah. I'm such a badass, yo. Like, why do you need to get high immediately after you just took a life? Yeah, dude. I'm Grand Theft Pussy. Yeah, man, I'm so wild. Let's go car hop so we can buy some weed, man, because I'm a loser with nothing going on in my life. Because kids used to make fun of me, so I used that as an excuse to just smoke weed or I wanted to fit in. And everybody uses me because I just have money and I get weed for free. I have no real friends, man. Let's get high. I just killed a cat. Shut up. Ridiculous. His mother, Donna, later told an official in the attorney's office, thank God he killed an animal and not another one of the family members. Now, if you want to have your cat clinic, and now if you want to somehow be allowed to have animals in the house after that happened, that's not something you say publicly. Because there are animal activists like PETA that don't want to hear that. Whatever, the animals that... At least it wasn't a human being. Like, maybe you shouldn't say that out loud if you want to have this animal shelter at home. It's hard enough to adopt a cat. I remember back in 2002 and somewhat in 1998 when we adopted my cats, it took forever. Can you imagine what it's like now in 2015 with the fake outrage when you're trying to adopt a pet? So for his mom to go, at least it wasn't one of us. It was just a 7 week old cat. That's not going to help out your cause, honey. Just saying, maybe you don't want to have animals in the house. But I'm just saying, if you want to have some respectability when it comes to having animals, and you probably shouldn't say that. I'm just saying, hey, do what you want. I don't care. The judge told Salami that there is some anger in you that needs to be addressed. Really? When you get mad over the dad not letting you sell your sibling's TV and then you kill a cat to death because the sibling won't give you back the bong, so you crush a cat to death. Obviously, he has anger problems. He might even have mental problems from smoking weed his whole life like a loser. So, he is now living with his grandfather. Can you imagine just living with her grandfather after you kill a cat. Just how weird that is. It's weird enough to live with a grandfather just because of the age gap, especially when you're Axel and you're a loser with nothing going on in your life. But you just killed a cat to death. It's not like you got a DUI or weed possession where it's less awkward. You killed a cat. I can't imagine Grandpa being very nice to you. Judge of this matter said that he was concerned that Salami had violent tendencies and was beginning to put together a lot of criminal offenses at a very young age. Of course, dude, he's got to be wild. Yeah, got to be like the gangbangers in Chicago that are taking away lives because that's so cool and edgy. Yeah. Ugh. All righty. I don't get the young punks who think it's cool and necessary to just want to be like the gangbangers. It might be cool in The Wire, but even in The Wire, it shows why gangs aren't cool. Sons of Anarchy, Sopranos, all those shows, Boardwalk Empire, make it seem like being the life of a dude in a gang is so awesome. It's not. Never been in a gang. I never will because I actually want to do something with my life. I'm just saying, if you are trying to kill a cat over a bong being taken away from you after you're trying to sell your sibling's TV, which wasn't your own possession, there is something wrong with you.
Happy Hour is about to end, but first, it's time for Last Call. Ow.
All right, we're about to get the hell out of here. I appreciate everybody. We have a record amount of listens via Spreaker. Everybody who listened to all 90 minutes of this show, talking about pedophilia, talking about potheads, talking about teenage parties, and everybody with the kind word about my little speech about my dad. I got a really nice comment on Facebook. A really nice message that was put up by Nervous Jared from the Miguel Show on Hot 101.5. It says, without him knowing, I was able to sit outside and hear Ryan Hoppe in depth talk about the passing of his dad. Much respect to him for sharing everything to people he doesn't know. Thank you so much, bro. That really means a lot. And it's one of those things where it was a way to vent. Because I don't want to talk about it to my mom and keep making her depressed or my aunts that are going through a lot. I kind of felt like telling random people just to be not humble, more like you can relate to me. Because sometimes I was known as RMG Hoppy on Rover's Morning Glory, or I'm Badass Ryan, or Franken, or Goofball Hoppy on Mike Kelta Show, which I love. I love being on the Mike Kelta Show. You've heard me on A Cat Named Mo Show or the BDRS. But I want you guys to get to know me as a person on Hoppy Hour. So we have the rants, we have the wacky bits, we have my co-host, we have the interviews with people in radio and comedians from around here that are hilarious, but I also want you guys to get to know me, so I'm going to begin sharing memories about my dad, and now I'm doing things on the weekend because I have the weekends off and I'm not doing pizza delivery where I don't get tipped, so now I'm going clubbing with my friend Kyle, the co-host of Hoppe Hour, so Hoppe Hour is going to be more personable. And a show that you can relate to. So if you want to hear more of it, just download my app in the iPhone and Google Play Shop. Just search up Hoppe Radio. You can listen to all 35 of my interviews. You can chat me live when the show is live, like right now, and you can hear all my rants. I don't care if you live in Auckland, New Zealand, Gary, Indiana, Cleveland, Cincinnati, Tampa, Newport Richie, Arlington Heights, Illinois, Milwaukee. You can hear us anywhere in the world. So there's no excuse ever to miss Hoppe Hour. You can listen via the app. Because that is the future of audio entertainment as we know it. Just search up Hoppe Radio and spread the word. Support Hoppe Hour and Soli's Graphics out of Duluth, Minnesota by going to tinyurl.com/hoppehourdecal. That is tinyurl.com/hoppehourdecal. For just $2, you can buy some badass decals. And that's about it. Tweet at me, at Ryan Hoppe Radio. Email me, ryan@hoppyradio.com. And HoppyRadio.com. I think you get the point of me trying to sell my brand. All right. This has been Hoppy Hour. Next week, we have a full slate of interviews, and Kyle will be back. I appreciate you listening. Peace out.
Tequila Sunrise. Hold the sunrise.
It's on the house.
Well, aren't you a sweetheart?
Do you really think the bartender just gave you a free drink because he's a sweetheart?
Yeah, why else?
Because your pants are so tight I can read the mileage on your vagina.
That is so sexist. I don't get preferential treatment because of my looks. He gives out drinks because he's a nice guy.
Can I get a glass of tap water?
Beat it, SeaWorld!